Hello friends, welcome to this channel, and we are continuing with our discussion on the fundamental concepts of 61850. In the last session we have already discussed about some of the important substation automation concepts, that is, what is the meaning of interlocking, how interlockings are implemented using 61850, and what are different types of controls generally. What are the difference between process control and substation control? And in this session, I am going to discuss about the goose, then the publisher subscriber concepts. So, without wasting any time, let us start with today's topic. And the first thing which is here is the goose communication for protection as well as for control. Basically, if you see this word goose, goose means generic object oriented system event. So goose is generic object oriented system event. Basically, goose is an unacknowledged, this is a keyword I will explain, multicast message. So there are two different terms here. Goose is an unacknowledged multicast message that is repeated with a certain strategy, allowing the supervision of the horizontal communication. So this is not that much important. Goose is basically an unacknowledged multicast message repeated with a certain strategy, allowing the supervision of horizontal communication. First of all, what is the meaning of multicast message? Basically, there are three different terms. One is unicast, another is broadcast, and last one is your multicast. So unicast, for example, suppose you want to talk to your friends. So in that case, what we need is you have to call the mobile number of your friend, and then only you can talk with him or her. So in that in this case there is a requirement of one-to-one direct communication link through a mobile network between two of you, and the information can be shared only between two of you. So I am not talking about the conference call, I am talking about the normal phone call. So in that normal call, whatever you are saying is only being received by the other person at the other end of the mobile network. So this is unicast, which is a one-to-one communication between a publisher and a subscriber. Second is broadcast. So a better example can be an airport or a railway station. So on an airport, there are a continuous announcement about different types of flights or different flights from one city to another city. It may be of the same flight for which you are at the airport, or it may be for the different flight, because those announcement about the different flights are being done regularly, and it doesn't announce only for your particular flights. So the information is flowing from a publisher, is always publishing the message, and the subscriber knowingly or unknowingly are receiving all the informations at each and every point of time. Even though those informations are not suitable for or not helpful for that subscriber. For example, suppose you want to travel from city 1 to city 2. So you have to focus only on your flight, suppose flight A. But if there is an announcement of flight B, so you cannot say that please don't announce about flight B. They are going to announce about flight B also. It is the information which is available in the network all the time, and the subscriber doesn't have any option, he have to receive all the informations. So this kind of communication between the publisher and the subscriber is called broadcast. Another thing is multicast. So for example, a television or a radio. In case of television, suppose a football match or a cricket match is being shown on one of the television network or one of the television channel. So now this information is published on the television channel, but it is up to you that if you want to see that match, or if you want, if it doesn't want to see that football match or cricket match, then it is up to you. So in case of multicast, what is basically is that a publisher always publishes the message, but it is the subscriber who decides that whether they want to subscribe that message or not. So if the subscriber wants to tune into that particular channel, then only they can watch that match. Or for example, of this particular channel, I am always publishing the video, but it is up to you that you want to see that video or not. If you are not seeing that video, so that means even if I am publishing the videos, you are not seeing the video, so this is a multicast message. Another thing is that this is unacknowledged. So what is the meaning of unacknowledged? Unacknowledged means publisher always publishes the message. So publisher always publishes the data, but it doesn't know whether the subscriber has received or not received. So it will keep on publishing the data, but it doesn't know whether the subscriber has subscribed or not. So now for that, what you have to do, you have to repeat the message with certain strategy. Why you want to repeat? Because if you are repeating the message, then we generally conclude that if you are repeating the message several times, then it might happen that the subscriber may have missed the message on the first instance, maybe at the second instance also, but it might receive the message at the third instance. So this is the repetition. Now with a certain strategy, what is the meaning of certain strategy over here is, when there is no change in state, so suppose the breaker status is being, CB status is being transferred from one IED to second IED, IED 1 to IED 2, the CB status is being transferred. So presently suppose CB is in closed condition, so there is no change in state, so it will keep on repeating the CB closed state after some fixed maximum time interval. Suppose this time interval is 1 second, so it will keep on repeating the CB close status after every 1 second, and subscriber will receive the same message. Now suppose suddenly the CB close status changes to CB open status, so now this is a change in state, so it is important to transfer this change in state as quickly as possible. So now publisher publishes this message very quickly. So now suppose this will publish the message in every 10 milliseconds for 4 to 5 times. So within this 4 to 5 times, it will assume that your subscriber will receive the message, and now this message will be transferred very quickly, and after some time again this CB open status will keep on repeating with the maximum time which is set over here. So this is the basic concept of Goose, and this is one of the paper which was published by two author, Andrea Bonetti and Romain Doyeb, on the transfer time measurement of protection relay application with 61850 standard. Basically in a transmission system, your Goose transmission time basically are three types. One is the trip signal, then the sampled value, and then the other fast messages. Basically the trip signal and sampled value, it is transport with 3 millisecond maximum transfer time, and the other fast messages up to 20 millisecond. Then in the same paper, they have discussed what are the time which is required for this Goose transfer time, what are the time it involves. First of all, this is a physical device which may be your suppose ABB REL670 or RET670, or it may be 7SA52, that is Siemens make distance relay, or it may be P444 or P442. So this is your physical device. Now this physical device, once it, on the basis of algorithm, suppose it's distance protection operated, suppose PDI is operated, so this communication processor, then it will take some time for this processing. Once it will operate on this, over this network, it will transfer this information to the second IED. Second IED, then it will process this signal, and then on the basis of that signal, it will take the decision. So there are two processing involved, one at the IED 1 level, one at IED 2 level, and then the information transfer time from one IED to another IED. So these three, TA, TB, TB, TC, these three together constitute your transfer time. So in the same paper, they have also discussed about this Goose and the conventional contact. What are the total time required in case you are using Goose for protection tripping, and what is the time required in case you are using conventional contact. So this is a very simple example in which IEDB is having some protection function, and on the basis of the operation of IEDB, we want IDA to trip. So now at this instant 0 millisecond fault is injected. This PIOC is protection inverse overcurrent. So inverse overcurrent protection of this IED operated, it will issue a trip command, PTRC will get active. Once it issues a trip command, one of the binary output gets high. Once this binary output makes, it will energize one of the binary input of the IED. So these are hardwired between IED A and IED B. So once this relay operates, one output contact is made. Once this output contact is made, it will energize one of the binary input. On the basis of this binary input, this is since an OR gate. So either this PIOC of this IED A, or if on the basis of this binary input, this will issue a trip command. Once this operates, this output contact makes, and this will trip your circuit breaker. So basically there the time involves are this output contact making, binary output contact, then this binary input, and then on the basis of input it will take the decision. So basically, suppose this relay takes some time of operation, suppose this time of operation is 26.99 millisecond for this particular example, which is lifted from this particular paper. So now this is 26.99 millisecond, and this contact making, then this binary input energization, this will take some time. And finally, suppose this IED operates and that time recorded is 34.93 millisecond. In the second case, what is done basically is, now we are not using any binary output input combination for our hardwiring. This is not hardwiring, is removed now. So instead of hardwiring, what is basically done, this port is injected. This relay inverse overcurrent protection operates, it will issue a trip command, PTRC gets active. So now this PTRC signal through goose, it will be transferred to here. And now on the basis of this signal, since it is an OR gate, it will issue a trip command. And this time recorded now is 30.19 milliseconds. So there is a saving of 5 milliseconds if you are using goose for tripping instead of conventional contact. So this is again shown in the same paper. 35 milliseconds for conventional contact and 30 milliseconds approximately for your goose technology. So basically we have discussed about the control interlocking or horizontal communication in the first session. Also in the first session we have discussed about the protection schemes, the horizontal communications. Now the second part, which comes is the vertical communication, which is the communication between the IED to your SCADA system or IED to your HMI and servers. So now this I have already explained, that this is the bay level, then the station level, and below that bay level there are process level. So before standardization, before 61850 standard, all the individual manufacturers, all the individual IED vendors, they were using some of their proprietary protocols. For example, this ABB, they were using SPA or loan protocol. Then your Siemens, they were using Profibus, Modbus, and then the GE or Alstom, they were using Courier and K-Bus. Similarly, SEL Relay, they are having their proprietary cell protocols. So now, if you want to transfer the information from this IED to this HMI, you cannot use a common communication media over here, because you need protocol conversion from this courier protocol to one of the suppose the supported protocol of this SCADA. Then you need a protocol conversion of this, protocol conversion of this. So this is a very tedious job, and you need multiple protocol converter. This you can understand through a simple example. Suppose you know one of the language, suppose you know Hindi language, and you are having three or four friends who doesn't know Hindi, but they know suppose three different languages. So now if you want to communicate with all of them, you need the language converter, or you need some person who can convert one of the languages to Hindi language so that you can understand in better way. So in that case, there is lot of complexity involves in the earlier system. But the another thing that might be there is that suppose you also know English and all of your friends knows English. So in that case, you can directly communicate between your friends without the need of any conversion, or without the need of any protocol converter. So in case you standardize the communication language, then the needs of protocol conversion vanishes. Now this was before the 61850 standardization. There were numerous protocols available across vendors, as you can see RP or 570, RP571 under SPABUS for ABB, then CEL 451, 421, 311, then Schneider Modbus, then Copybus, etc. So now, in case of 61850, what basically is done, this protocol are standardized. So now this is a common communication protocol between different IED manufacturers, and these IED now can transfer the data through this common substation bus, and this is mentioned in 61850 application. And this reporting from this IED to your HMI, this IED to your HMI or through this SCADA system. Now if you see over here, this is from this one of the level, which is bay level, to the next level, that is station level, and this one lower level to one higher level, this is the vertical communication. So in case of SCADA, this communication is your vertical communication. So now the communication from the IED to your SCADA system, from the bay level to station level, is vertical. And what this IED from different vendor now can exchange and use information over a communication media, over a common communication media. And you know, no need to have a protocol converters, and this reporting is vertical communications. So the communication between SCADA and the IED is defined in 61850 standard. This is manufactured multimedia message system, then file transfer protocol, and data exchange can be what data you can exchange between your bay level and from this IED to this. What data we can exchange? We can exchange the data of, suppose, the control and monitoring of breakers, isolators, etc. Or we can transfer some events, we can transfer some logs. So control, that is the operation of the primary objects, then the log, that is at what point, particular point of time, the isolators were operated or breaker was operated, then the reporting of events, that is, suppose the breaker is open, breaker is closed, trip coil faulty, SF6 low, etc., then the disturbance file uploads. So now this we have discussed, this is your SCADA vertical communication. The next thing which comes under this, if you see over here, the important portion here is this portion, which is substation LAN, and then the substation bus or substation LAN. For this substation bus, what we need is Ethernet switches, and this Ethernet switching, it is mentioned in 61850 standard, and that we will discuss in the coming slides. So this data traffic runs on Ethernet 100 Mbps. This means that in 61850 substation there are Ethernet switches that we already know. So these are, suppose, 5 or 6 IEDs. This, from this IED you want to transfer data to this control center or local control room. So now you cannot transfer data directly from this IED to this through fiber optic cable or through LAN cable, but you need Ethernet switches, and all devices should communicate to those Ethernet switches. And once it communicates to Ethernet switches, from this Ethernet switch it will be communicated, or it will connect it to your station computer. So the protection and control signals are dependent on the correct functionality of the communication system, which has in the Ethernet switches one of the most important factors. So the network topology, again, I am not going to discuss in detail about the various types of network topology. I am going to give you only a brief idea about two of the network topologies, which are star and ring. In case of star, if you see the IED, suppose there are numerous IEDs, these all IEDs are connected to one common Ethernet switch, and this Ethernet switch is then connected to your remote computers or your local SCADA system. So this computer's local SCADA system is connected through this Ethernet switch. This is a very simple system, but the only drawback is that once this Ethernet switch fails, all the SCADA communication gets disturbed. The modification is rings, in which, suppose, some of the IEDs in one SPR or one kiosk, it is connected to one Ethernet switch, then second set of IEDs in the next kiosk or next SPR or next cubicles, it is connected to second Ethernet switch, then all Ethernet switches are connected in a ring shape to your common substation Ethernet switch, and from that Ethernet switch it will be connected to your local SCADA system. This is a little bit complex system, more costly because large number of Ethernet switches are required, but this is a stable system. Presently, double ring systems are used for more stability. In 9-2, the protocols which are used are called PRP, Parallel Redundancy Protocol, and HSR, that is Highly Seamless Redundancy Protocol. Here in 8-1, the ring topology, the protocol which is used is called RSTP, that is Rapid Scanning Tree Protocol. But I am not going to discuss in detail about this RSTP. I will discuss about RSTP in some of the separate session. So now I have covered one more topic, which is network topologies. I will keep only up to this point. For the sake of better understanding, we will meet again for one last time on these fundamental concepts of 61850. And in that session, I will discuss about the 61850 SCL languages. Then what is the different engineering processes of 61850? What is the meaning of ICD, CID, SCD files? How these files are created? How these files are imported or exported? And finally, in the end, I will also discuss about 61850 9-2. So if you like this session and if you like the content of this channel, then please share this video with your friends. Also, if you doesn't like the contents, if you are having any problem in these sessions, then you may comment in the comment section, so that based upon the feedback received from your side, I will try to improve from our next session onwards. And I will try to make these sessions more and more interesting based upon the feedback received from your side. So thank you. We will meet again with the last part of this series. Till then, bye-bye.